You're listening to iCannabisRadio.com. A little higher.
John Doe Radio. Name something that gets passed around.
Chris. A joint.
A joint. A joint. This is when you know we're going to hell.
John Doe.
Supposed to put on your devil suit when you come up in the church, young man. Now they ain't about to think you a rebel. You about to make them think you birthed from flames. La 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 di da da. Wanna be on TV just to show out for me, mama. But breaking into colored houses, it means that it's a bitch when you're sick like this. Putting all the face paint I can put on. Put my black jeans and black hood on. That show TV I just stood on. With a faded habit, this brother swerves when I sip vodka. I'm the latest rabbit, in other words, I'm a hip hopper. You disc jockers never played me, you said my shit stopped ya. 2001, I mixed opera. Now every click's got the sick cocker with lots of ripping about they chips. Otter. Listen to this quick chopper flipping the proper with the spirit of fucking Big Papa. Yeah, this for your motherfucking rap. My shit is surprising and shocking like Barack votes. The trap's broke when I rap with Tucci and Stacks, though. OG Mug said I'm gonna be the first rapper to cross over to black folks. Yeah, I'm breaking into colored houses. Polo boots and hella dark colored outfits. Yeah, I'm breaking into colored houses. Fellas better put a chastity belt on your spouses.
It must suck to be you niggas, cause it don't suck to be this bitch. If you not fucking with me, brethren, you can suck.
My people dodge me like Durango. Now at my shows, I see more N-words than Django. From Missouri, like Nelly Chingy and Chang Hang Low. But Kansas City, somewhere over the rainbow. I'm in your house, baby. I'm in your living room. Looking down your blouse, lady. And everybody is in tune. To Tech Nina, sex fiend, a threat to his and whom. They got a beautiful woman and give him boom. They want it because I'm about to be big and boom. Breaking into colored houses is hard, man. Cause everybody got guns, and they got dogs, and they got bars, man. But I'm coming through that TV. And all the ghetto was gonna see me sipping the KCT. Nigga, no Tech Nine, now everybody wanna freebie. Damn, I'm breaking into colored houses. Polo boots and hella dark colored outfits. Yeah, I'm breaking into colored houses. Fellas better put a chastity belt on your spouses.
Damn, it must suck to be you niggas, cause it don't suck to be this rich. If you not fucking with me, brethren, you can suck.
Like Diana Ross. No, this ain't MMG, but I am a boss. Although I'm wicked, see, I'm fly and I floss. So why am I lost? Like my jammer's off. Yes, you a day late. Better late than never. I'm a veteran. My cheddar been truly silly like Stevie J face. Every last one of these evil haters, they see me vacate. To the crib, turn on the television and see my face like,
hey, wait.
Hey, wait. Hey, wait.
Hey, man, it must suck to be you niggas, cause it don't suck to be this rich. If you not fucking with me, brethren, you can suck upon this dick. Man, I just get it how we get it where I live. Somebody better call 911. I'm breaking in these niggas' cribs. Yeah, we out here working. One thing for sure, two things for certain, I'm for real. That's how I live. Somebody better call 911. I'm breaking in these niggas' cribs.
Extreme, you know what I'm saying? Like, fuck what everybody doing, we doing this. That's the Strange Music spirit. Fuck you, you own bullshit, we're going this way. That's the Strange Music spirit.
JDR News.
Welcome to the John Doe Radio Show. I'm your host, John Doe Shillin. My man, Adam Dunn over here.
Yo, yo, yo.
What are you doing, Adam?
Well, you know, waking up. That's how this is rough for me.
I know this is sort of an early point in time for you today, so.
I got to drive down from the mountains, you know, so it's a little extra early.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. It's good for me.
It is good for you. Maybe you can get more.
I got a kid now, you know. I got to, like, kind of grow up, I guess.
Maybe you can get more done during the day now, getting up early and stuff. One thing I found out.
Live up to my name, right?
Yeah.
Get shit done.
Thank you for hanging out with us on John Doe Radio. iCannabisRadio.com. Monday through Friday is when the show airs. God, this camera is so dark here. We need a new little camera here. This one, the one you got, is nice. And
of course.
It makes you look beautiful and awesome. And now I just look dark like death here. So, I don't know. Anyway, big thanks for hanging out with us on iCannabisRadio.com. Check us out Monday through Friday, 11 to 1. Adam's going to be hanging out with us on Wednesdays here on the John Doe Radio Show. Going to be filling in time with us.
A little hempy hump day going down.
Yeah, hempy hump day, which...
I mean, it's not the official title, but I'm just throwing that out there. I figured for radio, I'd go on hump day because that's how I remember radio back in the day. It's always about hump day. It's like hump day forever.
The Wednesday hump day. Anyway, he's going to be hanging out with us on Wednesdays, chilling, talking about news, and we'll have guests in and all that great stuff. So I'm very happy to have Adam along with us. Been trying to kind of make this work out for a while now, and glad it finally did. So it's cool. Cool. Big thanks to everybody who makes this show happen, our sponsors on the John Doe Radio Show. Big thanks to Edson, Mayton, and Matts. Edson, Mayton, and Matts, warrenedson.com. If you need criminal defense, family law, cannabis consultation, any of that good stuff, they got offices here in Denver, office in Aspen. Go to warrenedson.com to find out more information about that. Also, big thanks to Kind Love, one of the best spots to pick up any type of shatter. That kajak. Is that a jack? The shatter that you can get at A Kind Love Amazing. That's mmjdenver.net to find out more information off of that. That's right off of Colorado Boulevard in Leedsdale. I think they have a few locations, though, too. So make sure you holler at them. mmjdenver.net. CO2 oil, if that's what you're looking for. The only people that I can absolutely recommend that you go to and get CO2 oil from is the good people that we have over at Evo Labs and Element 420. That's at 82 South Federal Boulevard. 82 South Federal Boulevard in Denver. And right off of like Alameda and Federal right there. So the Dispensary Green building, because there's Dispensary Green. And that's what a certain green for dispensaries is. Right?
I think it's the most common dispensary color.
No, it's like the most, it's ridiculous. So anyway, go check them out, 82 South Federal Boulevard. And also, big thanks to Compassionate PM, Compassionate Pain Management. Two locations, Lakewood and Louisville for your service. Congratulations again for them getting an awesome sign put up right under the King Super sign, who hates marijuana and wants no marijuana stores anywhere in their little... You know how you go to King Supers and there's like a bunch of stores lined up and there's usually like a Home Depot to the left or whatever?
They're Kroger paradise, basically, is what they're trying to create.
Kroger, 100%. Kroger is not... I tried to get a job at a convenience store down the street. Two different convenience stores, two different... Conoco and then...
I think it's a bit too high end of a job for you.
Dude, obviously.
You obviously went way over your head.
Because they were like, would not hire me because of my drug conviction. So you can't get a drug job as a drug felon or with a drug conviction at a Kroger.
Well, obviously, you know, you're in a real critical position there.
I know.
Serving the public.
Serving beer and handing out scratch tickets, all that. I mean, we can't have dangerous people doing that.
No.
So check them out, 82 South Federal Boulevard. We already passed that. And Compassionate Pain Management is CompassionatePM.com. CompassionatePM.com in Lakewood and Louisville. Great people. Sean contacted me this weekend. I think wants to work on some other stuff and wants to come into the show. So, Sean, I will contact you. I did get your message this weekend. I got a story from the light rail.
Tell us.
I got The fans and the people in the chat, they enjoy the stories from the light rail. But usually because it's just ass hattery of me and whatever. Number, I did smell quite a lot of weed on the light rail today as I was going. Like, people weren't actually smoking it, but you could tell it was like
post-smoking.
Yeah, obviously. They were like blazing up. Like, somebody I sat next to. Like, I sat next to this older woman, and there was nobody around. Nobody around me. And I'm like...
You sure it wasn't just blowback there?
Dude,
that's usually the case. Usually when you're looking around, it's you. You know, and you're like, oh,
no, there was,
it was actually me.
Maybe it was, but it was like too fresh. I kept looking at this old woman sitting next to me, and I was like, did you just get done placing a doobie before you got on? Because why didn't you share that shiz? She's like, it's my medicine. You can't have it. No, but that did. It freaked me out. And then what freaked me out even more, I'm going to try and keep my calm at this point in time because it pissed me the fuck off, man. I was probably this close to getting arrested. Like, what they could have...
Once again.
Dude, I've been okay with staying out of trouble lately and not being arrested and not having issues. Like, I've been proud of myself for that. Like,
I watched you handle yourself in front of the police, so I know. I had to pull. You remember? I had to get you out of the way during the carnival because
you were
about to get yourself arrested there too. So you're good at that.
Thank you.
If you ever need to get arrested, just call him up and have him join you.
Somebody else mentioned that the other day too. It's like you down for the cause, dude. You're willing to step in between the police and whatever situation is going on and just run your fucking mouth. That dude, like, he got so pissed at that cannibal situation that I was mouthing off so much. He's like, you know, I could arrest you for running in the door without a license. And I was like, what? I never even heard of that. There's no law in Colorado about, like, running the door without a license. And I was like,
show me the door license, please.
Yeah, dude. He's just trying to get me to shut up. And that point in time, you were like...
Yeah, well, you know, you have to use Jedi mind tricks in those moments. You can't give them the obvious, you know? You hand them anything, they're going to grab it, but...
And you're good with that. You're kind of like that calm, no piss you off type of dude. Like, you seriously have that calmness. Even if you're doing something you shouldn't necessarily be doing, there's just something about you, Adam Dunn, that's like...
I mean, I've pulled myself out of a few situations like that, that's for sure. But again, you just have to use the Jedi mind tricks. It's not that hard, you know? It's just like...
It's not that hard.
These are not the droids you're looking for.
It's not that hard for you to pull it off. That's what the thing is. Anyway, anybody in the chat room, I guess I have like people copying my chat room name again. We've had nothing but like just trolls the past week. Since Spike left on the show, everybody like trolls. Like there's 10, 20 people that are...
They're all named after you.
Like at least 5-6 people, 5-6 people in the chat room that pretend to be me or just troll the shiz out of everybody in the chat room. So the fact that you're Adam Dunn, it probably saves you from any of this trolling.
Well, I basically don't give in. That's the key to the whole thing. I mean, I learned years ago when I tried to, answer somebody on a. I think it was MySpace or something stupid like that, but it was like, oh my God, this is not good. You know, all of a sudden it pulled you in and you had to, you know, answer and come back with your, you know, and it was just like, you don't know who you're dealing with. You're probably dealing with this little 14-year-old kid who's never in his life even seen a cannabis plant.
So the last time you got trolled was on MySpace?
That shows you how long ago before I was really actually active in this community, so... No, but I just try to, I mean, I'm guilty of trolling myself because I don't really like to talk about things. I just like to cruise around and see what's going on. But when it's active and it's like, you know, it's malicious, it's always a bit of a pain in the ass. That's for sure.
Yeah, no, that's what's, and I mean, that chat room means absolutely well. And I love them. But seriously, like, I have to get a point to where, like, I can ban them. Like, we can't ban anybody in here and... I think they like it that way. I think that maybe that would be a stupid thing to like change.
I'm sure you'll have just as much entertainment as they will, I'm sure. If not more.
Damn it. Oh, we do have quite a few people in the chat room. Thanks for hanging out with us on the John Doe Radio Show. Adam Dunn from T.H.Seeds, Hemp Hoodlamb is joining us. By the way, we did. I mean, people should already know who you are because you've been on the show quite a bit. There's, if you go on the JohnDoeRadio.com site, and I'll get to the light rail story here in a second. The John Doe Radio Show site, Google Adam Dunn, and there's plenty of interviews there. There's a 3-hour interview that we had with Adam when I first met Adam, and Derek was on the show. I mean, one of the best interviews that we've had here on the show. You know, enjoyable, funny, and informative. If you want to learn about Adam,
I don't know why you'd want to learn about me, but
we've had conversations in depth about the Cold Creek Kush and that craziness, which I won't bring up. I'll just leave it there, okay? I know that you'd be...
I mean, I don't care. It's one of those ones where now when I see it, it's one day it's Cold Creek, one day it's Cold Creek. It's like, come on, guys.
It's coal, you know, or cold or...
You know, it's Cold Creek. Come on.
I know. And it's one of the best strains out there, period, in the story. I love it. And
it's actually... I heard some good reports from East Coast, the guys who ran the Cannabis All-Star thing that went off last year. They said it's just crushing it right now in Rhode Island. It's the strain of the moment. So
really,
glad to hear that.
I like it. I like it a lot. It's something I can't seem to get my hands on though. I know I can. I just got to pay for it.
Sometimes that's the hardest part, right?
It's for me. It always is the hardest part. Shoot, I haven't dabbed since Bike left.
Well, I brought some dabs, so.
Yeah, Tim's gonna be dabbing today, courtesy of Adam Dunn. Although
Pink,
we gotta
Pink
find
House, Pink House, actually. Pink House is the one who'll be sponsoring this one.
Yeah, Pink House. Although we gotta find the torch, dude.
Oh no.
I don't know where
this
the
is tech fail.
Like, I really don't know where the torch went. I meant to ask.
That's the only problem with the whole dab culture now is that you're constantly on this search for the one missing material, you know? It's like back in the day it was like a lighter. That's all you really needed was a lighter.
Yeah.
Lighter and papers. And sometimes those were hard to find.
Papers.
But now it's a combination of torch, dabber,
rig
that you like, you know, rig that you like, because you might have 10 rigs that you don't like, you know, it's like people get real spoiled. And then on top of that, you got to have the right material, you know? So it's like, God, this is really work. And then somehow when you're in a hotel room at the right time, it's like you're missing the one element, you know? That's what happened the whole last Cannabis Cup. Every single time we got in a room, we had a plethora of material with no torch or no dome or no nail. You know, it's like, God.
Check this. Have you ever tried to dab off an iron?
No, but I could see it probably working.
Dude, it doesn't work.
Oh, okay, well then I could see it possibly working.
It doesn't work. First of all, like, if it got hot enough, you're gonna dab whatever was on the iron and residue, and it tastes like fabric softener. When we were in Vegas, and I had this horrible migraine, and I was like in the room, you know, like trying to black out with everything, and like I didn't have the rig with me, and they were all at the wherever the fuck the age or whatever it was at the time in August, they were all there at the glass event, and like, so I'm at a glass event in Las Vegas with no glass rig around, so I like think maybe this will work, you know, off of the iron.
It was a noble attempt, I guess.
It was a noble. I waited.
Cranked that puppy up, obviously.
Got it like a little funnel, you know, thing, a little funnel with the paper so that I could like hit it, dabbed it on there, dude. Oh my God, it was so slow to dab. It was farked up. And then the funny thing is, like, Josh came back and he was so farked up. He's like, why the fuck is this? And one of the only balconies in, we're staying at the Imperial Palace, and one of the only balconies that's like open that you could actually like jump out of, you know, because they stopped doing that, like, mm-hmm. You can't walk out on your balcony anymore. He goes, what the fuck is this iron doing here? And like the balcony's open, and like just goes, and luckily this is late at night where there's no one in the pool down below the Imperial Palace, and chucks the iron out the window of the Imperial Palace into the pool. I'm just standing there like...
Nice, nice.
I'm just standing there. I'm looking at him. I'm like...
Well, I had the same thing at the last show.
Did you just do that? Like, you...
I had the same thing at the last show where we were with... I was standing basically with three major players in the glass industry, you know? And we're all out in the parking lot ready to blaze. And I'm like, so, you know, who's got a piece on them? literally not none of us. We were inside. These guys have three giant booths filled with glass. Nobody's got nothing. We ended up using one of those slides to smoke water hash, which worked, but you know, it was definitely not the most ideal thing possible. But it was crazy how we just, you know, wow, here we are, all three of us, or those three guys are actually full owners. I mean, I should have at least been able to pick up a piece on the round, but somehow we just managed not to do it.
I know. That was the last time I ever bought a plastic piece was in Vegas, too. Like, because I couldn't find anything. And then
I was just shocked to see acrylic bongs in general. I was like, really? They exist still, you know? Like, people are still using it?
And so the graphics is still, like, tossing stuff around, which, yeah. I mean, if you're going to go with glass or going to go with acrylic, whatever, I guess that's the one to go with, but... just because they've been OG. But seriously, there's Boro now. Like, come on. Like, for less than $100, you can get...
Yeah, I was actually looking at some of the acrylic stuff and just had this little flashback, like, wow, you know, the things we've smoked through.
Like, water bottle. Like, seriously, this water bottle right here, I've made a rig before out of it. Like, totally. We all have. It's just something MacGyvered.
And you're usually proud of yourself after.
Dude, you are. You're like, look at this. This is engineering. I could totally go to engineering school after this, man. I'm so, like, I'm in. Meanwhile, it's like the worst damn, anyway.
Yeah, no, I've seen some. I actually got this Dr. Atomic comic book from back in 1976, and it's awesome because it has all these blown out kind of descriptions on how to build these pipes, but they're all made out of like toilet rolls, and, you know, things you just don't smoke out of anymore. You know, you're kind of like, I could probably pass on the glue toilet roll combo with, you know, the safety pin thrown in and just all these little bits, but it's ultimate MacGyver stuff.
For real. Yeah, that was the last time I bought a plastic piece, and we went into the shop, and like, there was no glass in there. Like, no glass, like, into this head shop. I mean, they had a bunch of blunt roll or whatever, and then it was just plastic. And this is in 2007.
Yeah, I mean, it's,
like, what the fuck?
It's pretty interesting to see how this industry it grows incredibly fast, but at the same time, it drags ass on a lot of things too. You know, like, there's some stuff where, you know, and also just the idea, like, even at the last Champ show, it was like a lot of it was porn stuff and, you know, things like, you know, just because they assume, oh, you own a head shop, you got to have Nong Champa incense and porn. I mean, that would be the most obvious thing you're gonna have. And it's definitely not. And that just kind of kills it for me. Every time I have that vibe of those old head shops,
yeah,
I don't understand why people don't just want to step it up a notch. I mean, you know, Illusions is a great shop here, but it's almost too big. You know, it's like so big and there's so much going on. A little bit more smaller, cozier, with some really nice pieces is about all you really need. You know?
Yeah, Illusions is a gallery. Like, I mean, it's not...
It's awesome. I mean, it's one of the greatest places to bring people to show stuff, but I have a hard time feeling like I want to buy something just because of the fact that I'm overwhelmed with too much stuff, you know?
And plus,
you feel like a pathetic fool when you ask them for this little, you know, $50 piece or something after you've just looked at these $50,000 pieces.
Their stuff is pretty overpriced, though, too, at the same time. I mean...
Yeah, I mean,
It's marked up heavily, heavily.
It's kind of in the zone of, if you have to ask, then you probably can't afford it.
Yes, exactly. Anything in that place, if you go into Illusions and you're looking for a piece, like, you know exactly what corner you're going to. Anywhere else,
yeah,
especially that middle section, anything that's in the middle.
Yeah, unless you're balling big time. And
don't even ask.
Exactly. No, but it's, like I said, great shop, awesome stuff, just sometimes a little overwhelming. And I think, especially on the East Coast, you really see how different the head shop idea is. I mean, West Coast is still kind of a little better, but at the same time, I think the problem is most of the time when you walk into the store, within 5 seconds, you can kind of tell if these people really care or if they're, you know, if they're just doing it because it's easy, you know?
Yeah.
And shops like Made, for instance, out in, they've got a shop in...
Who's constantly getting robbed.
I know. It's crazy, right? But they have great style, too, so it's like, you know, well... Maybe you attract all the wrong people at that point.
Yeah.
But
Chris Mazurik. I met him when he was out here. The 710 Cup with the Maid and all their glass pieces. They specialize in high-end glass. There's also this group on Facebook, like, really high-end glass for sale that I'm trying to get into just to be able to see, you know, what is in it. And, like, Derek and a few other people the other day were, like, showing off a few pieces in there. It's like... Looking to trade, blah, 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 blah. In parentheses, $5,000.
Yeah.
Like $5,000 freaking piece.
Yeah, no, it's... There's definitely some super high-end stuff. I mean, literally at that 710 Cup, just when the wind started picking up and I looked around and I saw some of the booths. I mean, I'm looking at the price tags on these things. They're all like, you know, $1,800, $2,000, $3,000, and they're just lined up.
Yeah.
And, you know, one big gust of wind. And that, I mean, I was already like scared for those guys. I was like, dude, wow, you're going to lose like $50,000 worth of glass if you don't watch out.
I definitely heard a few people lost some glass.
Yeah. I mean, actually, like, well, with the maid guys, I went to check them out the next day. I was like, you guys are all right? And he was really lucky. I mean, a few pieces broke, but they were all just little bits and bats on the piece. Nothing major, you know, stuff that could be repaired.
He's lucky you didn't have one of those the micros fall off. Those two, the two mini $3,000 bongs, man. It's like, yeah, here you go. You can check this out. It's $3,000.
Yeah. No, it's, I mean, I started selling glass in 93, and then that was kind of like the beginning of the big money glass, it seems like, because I had Jason Harris blowing glass out of my place in Amsterdam, and he had his crew with him, and we were like the only people in Amsterdam selling high-end glass. But the problem was it was always a price thing, you know, because people were coming over from America, and this is back when there was still guilders, so it was 2-to-1. So for instance, if there was a pipe that somebody would get $100 for, then they want 200 guilders for it. And but to the people there, 200 guilders felt like $200. You know what I mean? So there was it was no break. And then on top of that, you're trying to sell this culture to people who just smoke tobacco. You know, most of those people there couldn't see the value in a pipe, especially, you know, because they were, to them, the way to save money would be to roll more tobacco into their joints, you know? And to me, that's not the idea.
Dude, for real. And it's lucky. It's so lucky that we don't have...
Yeah.
Like, we don't have that type of big culture. There's a few people like, what? I mean, I can never smoke a joint with the Selecta because he's got it rolled. Spliff.
I mean, spliff culture, it's kind of interesting to see because I lived it, you know, as far as I lived in the...
Exactly.
And I was kind of battling it every day at my store. People come in and I'd have to explain to them like, hey, you know... probably shouldn't be mixing it with tobacco. It's not really good. And the biggest problem, I think, for places like the Netherlands, where they are prevalent about it, is they've never gotten to prove, you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt that that cannabis is healthier alternative to tobacco because everybody's mixing it. So, for instance, their cancer rates are just as high as they've ever been.
Yeah.
They don't have any kind of a benefit out of this smoking culture because they're like, because of the fact that they haven't really educated themselves and they're all mixing with tobacco.
I remember you saying a story. You would tell me a story of something like where you were on a ship or something, or you were doing something at one time, and it was like somebody was rolling up, you know, weed and spliff, and you were like, can I just get a little bit of that weed before you put it into the spliff and so I can smoke it? Like,
yeah, I know. And it's, I mean, I moved to Australia when I was 18, and that was kind of the first place that I encountered the whole spliff culture. But there it's even more extreme. There they actually mull it, and they have a little bowl, they mull it, they call it, which is mixing it with tobacco. Wow. And then they do bong hits of it, you know? So you're just like, wow, this is not good. And then that was my first day there. I had a job. I was catering, so I was really hot and tired, and you know, got out of the kitchen for a second, and somebody offered me a little hit off of a bong. So I thought, wow, this is awesome, you know? First day in Australia, getting a bong hit right after work, you know? Not telling me that it was black tobacco, which is even like the heaviest tobacco possible, mixed with some really low quality weed. So I turned green basically. My complexion went green. I passed out for about 10 seconds, and I felt ill beyond anything I've ever felt before. So it was definitely not a good idea. And then I couldn't believe that people would mix tobacco. And then after a while, I realized, you know, okay, it was such a powerful thing that I was there for a year, and by the time I moved back to America, I was already smoking cigarettes, you know. And luckily, I was so embarrassed because I'd been so anti-tobacco my whole life that when I got back home, I couldn't smoke in front of my friends, you know what I mean? Because they were just like, what? But it was really like, it got me, you know? I was sneaking cigarettes off my girlfriend, and, you know, it was just kind of like, wow, that really grabs you quick, you know? So,
dude,
tobacco's bad stuff. So that was the only time I ever smoked my whole life, pretty much, when I was 18 for a year, you know?
And damn.
So anybody out there smoking, stop.
Yeah, so luckily is that, I mean, and there's like him and this other dude, Max or whatever, that I know that I don't know. There's just a few people you know not to hit. And then another thing, funny thing is though, when we're all hanging out and chilling and like joints are getting passed around, like a year ago, everybody was hitting the joints. You know, give one of our, just one of our certain friends, like that usually has fire, whatever. You know the people. Like, you just see the person rolling up weed, and you know whether it's going to be good weed or not, and whether you want to hit their joint or not, because usually certain people have certain whatever. And now it's like, dude, it doesn't matter who's rolling the joint, even if it's like fire. That joint's usually smoked by just that person, and maybe one other person takes a drag, because you try to pass that shiz around now, and yeah, Nobody smokes flowers.
I know, it's kind of, kind of disheartening as a breeder to see people, you know, poo-poo on the flower all of a sudden. But I think it's, you know, it's time. It's one of those things where I think everybody's just obsessed now with their whole Earl situation that they, you know, and everybody's kind of one-upping everybody else. And that's just the way this culture's always been. So give it a little time. And I think, but what I do notice is anybody who's not directly living in Colorado, first though, all Colorado just, I mean, I can't even find a regular lighter nowadays. It's like, hey, does anybody got a lighter, you know? And it'd be like 9 torches come out.
I know.
And there's not a single lighter in the room, you know? And I'm like, wow, this is really Colorado situation right here. But for the rest of the country where it's kind of like new and, you know, there's definitely, it's kind of fun to watch. Like I've seen some guys, you know, and they're 60s, mid-60s, yeah, or so, friends of my mom's coming to town, and we show them for the first time, and it's like, I swear to God, these guys are like 15-year-old kids again, you know? They're just like, wow, that really worked, you know what I mean? So I can see, it's like kind of a, it's nice, it's a nice thing for people to see that cannabis really does work the way it should work, you know? Because yeah, a lot of times, people get stuck in their little spot, you know? And
yeah,
maybe they think, this stuff's, you know, whatever, and then you hit them up with something new, and wow, all of a sudden it's woken up again, you know. And it's just like when you eat edibles, you know, the first, like, it either doesn't work at all or it works too good, you know what I mean? Yeah. It's one of the, there's not really much
and
in between.
And honestly, it's hit and miss with me on certain days, like edibles are, when it comes down to talking about that, because I'm, you know, they don't really hit me sometimes. And I was given by Ryan these hash capsules, and like I try and take 2 every morning. And some mornings, I'll totally feel it, like completely feel like I've blasted. And then, well, all the time I get these hash burps like I just have now. Like, you get that hashy, you know, oil burp. And then other days, I'm like, I don't feel like it does anything as far as highness. I know it's probably affecting me positively. I know that I'm getting benefit from it, but I just don't launch.
Yeah, it's probably a lot to do with what happened the day before, you know what I mean? It's like if how drained you were or not, you know what I mean? And how, because the whole thing with a lot of the cannabis related stuff, and I mean pretty much the whole cannabinoid thing, meaning like, you know, maybe your cannabinoids are just lower that day, and when you take that pill, it really knocks it, brings it up to the right level, you know, where you're feeling correct.
Yeah.
And then maybe there's other days when, you know, it's already there and it just really doesn't do anything, you know? So I think that's kind of the other problem is that people don't get about cannabis in general. It's like, it's kind of just filling in the gaps, you know what I mean? It's nothing above and beyond what we already have in our system. You know, we already have all these regulators and cannabinoids already, and these are just artificial things that kind of mask them and give you a little boost, you know? And so I think a lot of it's the reverse. It's not getting really like that much higher. It's just getting that much more complete, you know? So sometimes it's good, sometimes it's necessary.
Yeah, no, I understand that completely. So today I get on the light rail.
Oh, yeah, let's get to the light rail.
I get on the light rail today, and I'm just chilling. I'm tired as fuck, man. Yesterday I took the day off because I had a super migraine that knocked me the fuck out. Just seriously, like, knocked me down. So I lost the day yesterday, and then I get up today, I feel great, fantastic, smoke, go to, you know, hang out in the light rail, and I'm tired, so because I ended up taking, you know, my medication helped me sleep, and I doubled up on it last night, so like this morning getting up, I was like, on the light rail, I like pretty much fall asleep, and all of a sudden I like hear this Denver police checking light rail fares. And like as soon as I hear Denver police or police of any kind and turn around and see a badge, immediately my heart just drops. I mean, I freak the fuck out, man. I do not like police. I do not like being around them. I can't shut my mouth around them.
Well, you got to understand, it's just like dogs, you know, they feel the fear, you know what I mean? So, so you're just feeding them the fear.
I do feed into that fear, but it was like, seriously, like all of a sudden, so I was calm at first. Like I was like, okay, fine. And I'm reaching into my pocket, pulling out the light rail fare, which by the way, at the light rail, some older gentleman was like, I was starting to put my money in there, you know, it's $2.25 for the ticket. And he like comes up to me and he has this bus ticket, you know, this bus transfer and also a reduced fare program thing. You know, he's willing to trade, you know, this is worth $2.25. He's willing to trade me $1.50 for it. So I thought for a second, I'm like, he hands me and I look at it and I'm like, all right, it's legit. Cause I was figuring he was trying to hustle me. So I gave him $1.50, went and kajak, stamped my little thing, and then I got on the light rail. And as I'm reaching into my pocket to go get this fee, and so here, I look up to this police officer, and I'm like, why is DPD, like, not a dick either? Like, did not sound like a dick. I was like, why is DPD checking light rail, you know, past what? Shouldn't you be looking for homicides or... Like, dude, seriously, it was an honest reporter question of like, why are my tax dollars paying you to check light rail tickets when there are police for the light rail? Specific, a whole army of wannabe police. Well, a lot of them came from Iraq, and now they're Iraq, you know, they're just veterans of the war that now got into law enforcement or RTD and whatever. And usually those dudes are pretty cool. Like, usually they're pretty cool. And, like, I ask him as I'm digging my pocket, I ask him, I was like, why is Denver police light rail fares? And he, like, just puts his badge in my face and says, Denver police. And I was like, I'm just asking you a simple question, buddy. And he's like, I'm just asking you a simple question, too. And, like, I look up to him and I, like, hand the thing to him. And I was like, why you gotta be such a dick about that? Like, what is the need of you to be... So much of a smart ass to me. Like, pretty, said that exact thing.
Maybe the roids were kicking in a little bit for him.
And then the next comment, he goes, look, because I'm wearing the JDR hat, I'm not wearing anything else. Like, obviously, cops are, you know, they notice everything. I don't have my, like, weed shirt on, nothing. And he goes, listen, I know you're high, but just show me your fare. Like, and I looked at him, I was like, how can you be so rude in what you're doing? Like, seriously, how can you be so rude in what you're doing? He looks at my fare, hands it back, and starts walking off. I was like, I straight up calling. I was like, thanks for being a jerk. I didn't realize there was another cop behind me.
Of course. There's always one behind you.
There's always two police, trust me. There's never just one police officer. And I forgot that whole situation of whatever. And she comes up to me and she goes, she looks at me and like leans down, she's like, does it feel good to get the last word in? And just like you had maybe mentioned to me a little a second ago, it'd be like, no, bish, you just put the last word in, not me, you put the last word in. And I was like, do you think it's okay for you to be completely irresponsible and completely offensive to someone who's done absolutely nothing wrong?
Well, they're trained. I mean, now you know. You notice how they're. It's a different attitude. I mean, you obviously have to prove your innocence more than they have to prove that you're guilty. You know, I mean, that's just the way it seems to be working these days.
Dude, seriously, got uppity with him. Like I raised my voice after she had said that. Whatever she did, like at that point, I was like raised voice, pissed off. The only thing, like I was about to get up and go ask the cop for his card to like complain, but I mean, and then it hit me. Number one, nothing's gonna happen if you complain. Nobody's gonna give a shit. And number two, there's a good chance that you're gonna end up in handcuffs by getting up and walking over there.
Once again.
So I Damn it, I don't end up in handcuffs that much. It's been a while. I'm about due. Knock on wood. Wait, that's fake wood. Like, dude, seriously. I stopped myself. I let it just burn inside me and rumble inside me. And then, yeah, whatever. It was bullshit, though, dude.
It's always bullshit. You know that.
Why the hell are Denver police checking light rail fares? The only reason why I could think that they were checking fares was that they were looking for someone.
Yeah, I mean,
or they got in trouble over the weekend and demoted to like light rail fare checker.
Possible.
Stupid. Two undercover.
Or they're just following you everywhere you go.
No, I don't believe that.
I think that might be the problem. I think that might be the situation.
It's some bullshit, dude. It was bullshit. Like. At the moment when he said, "I know you're probably high," dude, I wanted to explode. I was like, I wanted to, and like, I couldn't.
Funny part was, is you were high, so there you go.
I was.
It's not like he didn't know what was going down, right?
But I was not that high. I really wasn't. Like, no. I had taken one hit like 20 minutes ago or whatever, and dude, I wanted to explode on him at that point in time.
Well, it's like the classic though. I got caught. In fifth grade with weed in school and basically got totally snaked by my principal where he pulled it out of the drawer and he's put it on the table and said, "You know what that is?" And I obviously not going to say I knew what it was. So I was like,
"I have no clue.
Is that tea?" Right. You know, it just like looks like tea to me. Right. And then he said, "That's low grade marijuana."
That's low grade marijuana.
And I got so pissed off that I was like, no, man, that's Hawaiian, right? And he just totally got me. So I was like, man, you got me. But I had to
correct him.
I had to correct him. I couldn't believe they called it low grade marijuana. I was like, that is not low grade marijuana, my
you
friend.
You just
that is,
couldn't let it
that
go.
That is Hawaiian. That was like hard for me to get. You know, I'm in fifth grade.
You just couldn't.
I'm working
let it
hard for that.
It was the same thing with me, dude. Like when they said what they said,
they've been trained. You know what I mean? That's that to them is a key word to get you worked up. You know what I mean? Because they know that. I mean, it's not like they don't know that if they mention that you might be high, that you're gonna get a little bit worked up.
Yellowana.
Since they're following you and they know everything about you, then they really know that they're gonna piss you off. So.
Yellowana in the chat would be like, "The FARC low grade? This is the wine." And then you're like, "Oh, fuck."
Exactly. No, it was amazing. It was amazing how much I learned from that little lesson, though, because. You know, it's the classic red herring. You know, you need to throw the thing out there for them. And so,
yeah.
If you ever want to get any reaction out of somebody, just diss their weed and see how quickly they react,
dude.
It's
that,
almost like calling out their mom. You know what I mean? It's the same reaction. Like, you just said what?
Or here's the thing. Or go up to someone like Dredd and say, "Oh, hey, this is some nice pre-run."
Exactly.
I wanted to explode so bad when he said that, like the knocked on the stoners thing, like in. Spark your couch. I wanted to scream at that point in time. I'm like, it was so offensive to me. Fark you, if you're listening, cop. He's not.
I really doubt it.
They're still on the light rail checking fares. It's sad that they had, like, I was sad for them. After I got done being angry, I was honestly sad that they feel that, you know, hard ass. And feel that, you know, whatever, that they got to be a smart ass to whatever. Even the lady next to me, like, after they left, looked at me and, like, nodded to me. The old lady that smelled like weed, she was smoking the doobie beforehand.
She's like, "Thanks a lot there. Covered my ass."
Covered me. Like, that's probably why they were smelling like they smelled weed. Like, I wish I would have told them, you know what?
It's this old lady over here.
This shit's legal now.
Yeah, I mean they're gonna figure it out soon enough. I mean, it's one of those, like, we are definitely gonna be in the growing pains over the next 6 months or so, you know, until January kicks in. So
the last time I had a run in with the cops, they were talking shiz too about it rotting your brain and it being like this horrible thing. And then I like was like, but you know what? It's legal now. And like the cops straight up told me, "No, it's not." Like, what do you say at that point? Like, what do you say?
Well, I mean, he's just being overly correct. Obviously, it's not legal at this moment yet. It is legal.
It is legal.
Well, it's legal, but it's to the point.
At the time, at the moment where it was in my house, like, yeah. Where the weed was, like, legal weed, everything was legal.
Yeah.
Everything.
It's hard. It's a hard thing to wrap your head around sometimes. especially if you've been trained, you know, X amount of hours just to turn your brain around and to realize, okay, now this thing I've been trained so hard to be fight against is now the totally normal. Yeah. But that's also how the police work. If you notice, it's a lot like doormen at a club. You know, you tell them nobody comes in here with blue shoes. That's it. Nobody yeah. comes in here with blue shoes. They don't care if you're the guy organizing the party or not.
Exactly.
You got blue shoes on, you're not coming in. You know, and then the guy says, oh wait, hey, no, blue shoes are good. No brown shoes, you know, and then they'll just switch it up.
Yeah.
That's just the way they are. They have to, and they're just following their letter of the law to their, you know, and that's their job.
Exactly. They're just puppets.
And it's hard to do that. I mean, if you have half a brain, obviously you don't want to like go against what you think is, you know, morally right. And that's why I think some people are just not ever going to be a police officer, are they? So
exactly.
Me being one of those.
Me being one of those too.
I have a hard time with authority. You
know? Really? You're a lot more calm with authority, though. Here's the thing with authority with you. Like something that I noticed, like, especially that night at the carnival, was just, like, your whole thing is, like, ask for forgiveness later. And then while you're asking for forgiveness and doing what you do, you're perfectly calm about it. Like, you have a Jedi Zen way of dealing with authority, though, man. You're not like over the top. You just do it and then later ask.
I've had enough mistakes dealing with them that I think I've learned my lesson over time. I've always been just as bad as you at getting uppity with people and stuff, and I have a real smart assness about me too, so I kind of learned over the years it just doesn't seem to work. I mean, I've got
years to go to learn to get where you're at.
Yeah, and I mean, I think the biggest practice was mostly because I traveled so much, so I was dealing a lot with customs.
Yeah.
And you know, it was always an issue. There was always something in my bag I didn't want them to see, and it wasn't like I was carrying weed on me every time, but it's just either a bong or this or something. You know, there's always something, because I couldn't really travel without some excitingness. You know, some little exciting thing had to be like, oh, I picked up a new piece or whatever. And it was always a struggle to get it back to where you needed to. And so that was, I think, dealing with people on that level, because, you know, you have to show your best. You know, you can't come out and just come out swinging and expect them to not react. But I've had it in situations like in Canada when I was trying to go from Amsterdam to Canada. Then we had a diversion of our flight. I was going to Vegas, and they diverted my flight to Canada, of all places, because they had to...
What?
Yeah, and it was like, they were like, oh, we're going to be stopping in Vancouver, we have to clear customs with Canada, so it was, and then America.
What?
To go back to the States, so it was kind of strange, and of all, you know, I went through the Canadian thing, like, breezed through the Canadian side.
Uh-huh.
But then the American side, these guys had, like, a hard-on for me or something, because... They were like, oh, you're coming from Amsterdam, you know? And I was like, yeah. And they're like, oh, the city of sin, you know? And I was like, well, I'm going to Vegas right now. So I think that's the city of sin.
Yeah, really.
You know? I was like, I think Amsterdam's like a little village. It'd be the village of sin, if that anything. It wouldn't sound even a city.
And what's sinful about, like, Amsterdam? Weed and, like...
Weed and prostitutes, basically.
Weed and legal prostitutes.
Right. So but yeah, I mean, I got tore apart, and it was just... One thing after another, you know. I started off with the wrong answer, and that's I think a lot of it is, it's how you start the conversation is really how it's gonna go. It dictates everything.
Yeah.
So it's really coming in with the right initial thing, because if you start wrong, even if you have all the right intentions, you just dig yourself a bigger hole.
Dude, there was no way I could have gotten into that. Like, seriously, digging in my pocket and asking the kindest way that I've spoken to a police officer in years. Like, oh, so why are Denver police checking light rail fare? And the dude, like, totally took offense to it. Like, obviously, you think that what your job is doing right now is lowly. Fuck you, dude. Like,
you hit a sensitive spot, obviously.
Fark that guy. Seriously, fark that guy. And the chick that was with him, fark your couch too, biash.
There, you got that out now, right?
Yeah, I got it out. I'm done with it.
Oh, good. It was exciting. That was major. That was a major exciting thing right there. I was like,
I really, like, dude, it was one of the...
Live, I'm sure live it was way better.
I thought I was in handcuffs. Like, I seriously was waiting for him to say, sir, please stand up and turn around.
Yeah, I would have had the show all to myself.
That's what I was thinking in my mind, was like, damn it, Danny. Danny and everybody, like, cause we're like, I was supposed to have Danny on and talk to him later, and like, I was like, be like, damn it, Danny and Adam and all these people I got to talk to today. They're gonna have to explain them. Yeah, I got arrested for mouthing off to a cop on the light rail.
Oh well, we would have been proud of you anyway.
Anyway, all right. This weekend,
it's Bongathon weekend, isn't it?
August 3rd is Bongathon.
So that's this weekend.
It is.
It's a Bongathon weekend.
Are you going to go?
No. not negatively or anything. No, I can't make it.
I don't think I'm going to be able to make it either. Like, I would like to go, but as far as, like, burdening my friends with, like, rides or whatever, I'm done with that.
You would never do that.
Well, I've done it too much now that, like, people... It's just not even something I want to do anymore. And this weekend, dude, I, like, had tickets to Cypress Hill... And then I got stood up by my ride. Like, I'm waiting here for 5 hours. I'm waiting here for a ride to show up.
You just started walking 5 hours. You could have made it to Red Rocks.
I could have made it to Red Rocks in that amount of time. I was so pissed off. Didn't have money for a cab.
It's wow. Like, violins are coming out.
I know. I'm playing that. did you go?
Yes.
Did you have fun?
Yeah, of course.
Awesome. Did you get to meet the guys, hanging with the guys again?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
I mean, that's the thing is...
That's all I wanted was for you or Dredd to, like, just tell them what's up. Like, tell Sen what's up for me, because I need to get a hold of him again.
Yeah, no, we had good times. It was a good show. Weather held out, which is nice, because you know how it's been crazy around here lately. It's like, God, can't plan nothing.
I thought it might rain. I mean, people were like...
Well, it rained all day, and then it kind of cleared up, which is great. I mean, that's the thing about Colorado. You never know what's going to happen, you know?
Yeah, and it really is only going to rain for, like... It's very rare that it rains. You know in the morning when you wake up if it's going to be a cold day and rain all day. But usually if it starts to rain or whatever, you got 15, 20 minutes of rain, and then it goes away, and then days back to normal or whatever.
Sure.
So, 311... Who went on first? I mean, G Love Special Sauce went on first, and then yeah. Cypress Hill, and then 311.
Yeah, which I think I would rather have seen Cypress last. You know, I mean, because yeah.
I've heard 311 is not the greatest live.
Well, I mean, just you know, I'm not going to say anything big. cool. They definitely went off their. They weren't the 311 I remembered back in the day.
That's what I've heard.
It's definitely they popped out a lot. So
yeah, that's what I've heard. But Cypress Hill. Kills it live.
Yeah, I mean the thing is that, and you know that they're loving Denver, and just like when I was in Amsterdam, and they, you know, actually Cypress Hill, I was lucky enough to meet them in '93 when I first started my first shop, and that's kind of when,
yeah,
to me they were hot. You know what I mean? It's like I had their first albums, and I was like,
really, that was their first time of like being famous, and now they yeah. come around again.
Oh yeah, and this is their first time. That was their first time in Europe, and I had just opened up my store. And we met up with them at a shop, brought them over to our spot. And it was quite literally like we had a huge place, probably about a 4,000 square foot spot.
Yeah.
And we had like a table. That was about it. We had nothing. It's we awesome. Literally had just opened up.
I remember that story.
And so, you know, we hung out with them. And it was just definitely kind of surreal at that moment because it was like, you know, hey, these are my guys that I really was into. And... to see that they've actually like, because like it was also cool last night at the show or Monday or whatever went at the show. They're hyping up their. No, it was two nights ago.
Oh, it was because I did. I lost a whole day yesterday, dude.
You know, they're on their whole 20-year anniversary right now because it was 93. So they're so just the fact that they're up announcing their 20th anniversary. We're having our 20th anniversary. We hung out back in the day, and we still do.
Yeah.
And Kenji, who's one of their main guys who works with them, he's a good friend of mine from. Before the Cypress days.
Yeah.
So he was actually one of my friends before I ever moved to Europe. And so kind of also interesting to see, you know, we get to hang out and it's like we're still on our same path. You know what I mean? 20 years later.
That's awesome.
He's still working with Cypress. I'm still doing what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And we're still meeting up in different parts of the world. You know?
And that's what's funny is like one time, like I walk on a tour bus with Cypress Hill and all of a sudden I look over and like there's Adam sitting right there. And I'm like, whoa, what's up, Adam?
So. Yeah, no, it's like, and again, I think B is one of the cooler people in the industry. You know, there's not a lot of people that can keep their head kind of straight over the 20-year time frame.
A straight up gangster is why.
Yeah, he's a really good guy too, and he's like actually one of those like, because it's also one of the things you notice in the industry too is, you know, you you meet so many people, and you know, it's like I'll meet people sometimes too, and they'll be, hey, remember I met you at the store? And it's, I mean, I try to remember everybody, but it's really hard. I think with him, he's really genuinely like, you know, it took him a while to make the connection.
Yeah, because he doesn't open up to everybody. Like,
no,
he's fark your couch if you do not know. Sin on the other side, like I can talk for Sin for 3 hours.
Yeah, and so with B, it was like it took a little while, but once he established, you know, the connection and being in Amsterdam too, it made it like people actually remembered you a little more just because you're in a unique spot. But then, you know, now so many years later, it's like it's kind of nice because we can both see that we survived, you know what I mean, through this. Because it's kind of an interesting thing, this whole industry we're in is like to get to where you are now. If you were in it as long as, you know, we have been for 20 years or so, it's like that's 20 years of dodging bullets, you know what I mean?
For
and
real.
And
for you, like...
It's like living like the Matrix all day, you know, just bullets flying and you're just trying to... avoid them, because the reality is, I mean, what we've been doing has always been quasi, you know, it's been considered underground, honorable, but at the certain point of the time, you know, then you could always face a judge for it, you know what I mean?
And especially the seed situation. I mean, Mark Emery is a perfect example of that. Now, Mark Emery, granted, you know, raised the flag and, like,
he
threw all money. Like, he poked the lion.
Oh, yeah, for sure. No, you definitely, I mean... If that was what he was trying to accomplish, he did a very good job.
So hell of a good job.
You know, obviously, I don't think he was planning on this long of a time to be sitting for such a stupid thing as selling seeds. But, you know, martyrs will be martyrs.
Yeah.
And I wasn't really, that wasn't my intentions of this whole.
Yeah.
I mean, in the beginning.
Markowitz is another example of, like, somebody who, like, sort of was in a situation of intended to do good and by explaining some things, but then ended up.
Yeah. I mean,
and he's about ready to get out.
It's a classic example of, you know, raising your hand and asking for permission to do something and then just getting slapped the shit out of, you know what I mean? Where you probably would have learned that first lesson is like, maybe I shouldn't raise my hand, so, you know, just do it and get it done. And
that's how I view you, dude.
Well, that is how I've been doing things.
I totally view you as that.
Yeah, because it's just not a good feeling when you're trying to do something good and you're getting, you know, punished for it.
Yeah,
it's not a good, especially before you've ever even got to do it.
Yeah, that sucks. Yeah, Markowitz will be getting out in less than 30 days. He'll be in.
And I think Mark Emery's getting out so soonish too, right? Wasn't it?
Like, it'll be. He's still got a little bit of time left, but the thing was is like if Canada, like the United States, approved him to be shipped back to Canada, and if he's shipped back to Canada, there's a good chance Canada would say,
yeah,
we're gonna let you out.
Well, I'd hope so.
But the thing is, politically, Canada is not taking back any prisoner. Like, they are not taking, whether it be Mark Emery or anybody else, they are not allowing people back into the country. If you're incarcerated, you have to serve your time out in the United States.
Canada's a funny place, I'd have to say.
The conservatives there are the ones that done that, you know?
Yeah, I mean, when I was there, I was really, saw the two sides of everything. It was, like, amazing how... At one point, it's completely open, but then, like, at the border, they were as tight as could be because of the whole American influence, you know. I almost didn't get in. You know?
So, wow. Yeah.
I had to sneak in. So.
You don't say, you say that on air. That's the only way I'm getting into Canada.
Well, I had to. They wouldn't let me in because I was coming in from Amsterdam, and I had a lot of catalogs with me with seeds and things on it. And this was about 10 years ago, and I was pretty shocked. I couldn't believe that they would... Because my girlfriend was already there, and she told me that the hotel that we were staying at had a big, giant, like, neon weed leaf in the window. You know what I mean? That's how, like, it was, like, right above some shop. So I was like, okay, well, that sounds cool, you know? And then I brought all these catalogs. And,
yeah.
Wow, they weren't having it, you know what I mean? They basically pulled me out, sat me down, stuck me in a cell overnight, and told me I'm on the next plane back to Amsterdam. You know? And I was like, really? Wow.
What?
Amazing. But... Luckily, I was American, so I could kind of give him... I did the old same thing, little Jedi mind trick, like, I am an American. You can send me to America. It's a lot easier, you know? And so they sent me to Seattle, and then I just kind of, you know, made my way back, so...
But, dude, you crazy cat. You got more stories than a lot of the people that I know.
But you had to, you know... Well, if you went that far, I mean, I was going to fly back to... I had a whole family there waiting for me. I had my girlfriend and her sister and her dad, and they were all ready to go drive across.
No, I can't go back to Amsterdam.
No.
So far, like, send me in the opposite direction.
The funny part was I sat in the cell overnight, and I was with a bunch of Mexicans. So I'm at the Canadian border.
I've done that before.
I'm at the Canadian border sitting with Mexicans who have lived in America for, like, 14 years, have their own businesses, but... don't have their paperwork in order, so now they're getting deported back to Mexico because they tried to go to Canada to see some friends up there. I'm like, really? You guys are at the wrong border. You know, it was
what, how did you get deported from this end of the border? Like,
yeah, it was pretty hilarious. But really, it was kind of like every single person in there was in there because the Canadian government thought that they were there seeking work. I mean, that was really their big thing is that you're here to work, you know? And I was like, no, I'm just here to hang out.
And they don't want you. Like, you have to have a reason. You have to have somebody vouching for you.
Well, they actually said, the woman actually told me that the reason that they were not going to let me into the country is because of who I, well, because of the person that I am, that they feel that there's no possibility for me to be there for 3 weeks without breaking the law, meaning that I would be buying cannabis when I was there. And I was like, well, I'm actually here with my girlfriend and her father and his 75th birthday, and we're going to drive all around Canada. We're not, I don't even care about that. You know what I mean?
We don't trust you that you're not going to smoke weed for 3 days. I'm sorry, Adam, but I wouldn't either.
So I thought that was kind of funny. It was like getting told because of a crime you might, that they feel you would commit. And I was like, wow, is that even legal?
Hell yeah, it's legal.
And they said, of course it is. I was like, wow, you're in my country now. They're the exact words she used. So. Once they start talking in the first person like that, you know, as a country, like, all right, I think we've lost this battle.
That's awesome, dude. That's awesome. So, any strains lately that you've run across that are like, you know, you dug or that are out of the norm? So I heard.
I mean, I did a big run of a whole bunch of different things, and I had to say I was pretty disappointed. It was like kind of like every time you try something new, you're always expecting to see something that just out of this world or something. And, you know, I tried Girl Scout cookies and things like that. It was actually all right. I mean, the funny part with the Girl Scout cookie, which I was kind of the disappointing part.
Where'd
to
you
me,
try them though? Here well, or in Cali?
No, I mean, I got cuts. I grew out some cuts.
Oh, okay, okay.
So, and the thing is, with the Girl Scout cookie, what I was, the most disappointing part was that it tasted almost too close to Tangie for me. I was like, wow, it tastes like the Tangie. I'm like, oh no.
I've heard that a few times.
So
man.
I'm like thinking to myself, like, that's the unique flavor, is the flavor that we're all already about, you know what I mean? So it wasn't as exciting as I thought it was going to be. I was really expecting a bit more. I was expecting more OG influence or something off of it. But it really has that. I mean, it's the Granddaddy Durban cross is the one that I have. And then that's the, and it's, yeah, again, it really just has that flowy kind of Tangie flavor that you're, the flange, as we like to call it.
The flange. Dude, I heard another thing this weekend. The whole story about the Tangie was like wiped out for me. Like, there, nobody has a farking clue where, like.
Well, I mean, I just know it's a good plant. That's all I really care about right now. And I know I got the right one, so that's important. This whole Tangie thing is getting a little bit crazy, too.
Yeah,
I don't know what, because I can't really put my finger on it because they're totally not the same thing. You know what I mean? But yet they're supposed to. I don't know. It's a weird one.
There's a few crosses.
There's a big mystery there.
But yeah, as far as like the fabled Tangie that we talk about here on the show all the time, constantly.
I mean, it's a specific cut, and we have it, so it's good. And at least we can keep our finger on that pulse right there.
Yeah, and we have it. But the thing is, like, where it came from and what it is will never be known.
Well, that's a great thing. I like those mysteries in life. Never. You know what I mean? It's like, there's no strain out there, and I've said this many, many times on this show, there's no strain out there that's a stellar strain that does not have some sort of crazy story around it. Sour diesel.
The chat room's telling us Tangie equals Jilly Bean. It's a remake.
That's what I thought too. Yeah. So Tangie Jilly Bean seems way more on point because the Tangie has that real citricky kind of thing, and it makes sense.
Yeah.
Which is kind of suspicious also because it comes from the same zone and somehow it's got the name of one thing and the flavor of another. So it's kind of like, hey, and I've seen those both on the same tray many times. You know, I've seen them both in the same clone tray, which. Who knows what happens when it's a clone tray? I mean, there's many names mixed up. There's many things, you know.
I ended up getting like a selection of like 10 different cuts from somebody one time when I was growing, and it ended up growing them out. And None of them were
what
it was supposed to be. They were all completely mislabeled.
Yeah, no, I've seen people drop trays and just put labels back in. And you're just like, well, you just changed the course of history right there.
You did, for real. You just like, there's,
you know, you're better off putting question marks on everything and then going back when you know what it is.
Yeah,
you know?
when it's harvested out, you're like, okay, I know what this
is. You know, my mom goes crazy with me because I'm changing tags a lot because I can, if I know something, I'm not going to like call it something else once I know it. You know what I mean? It's sometimes I'm just as guilty as anybody. I have mistagged things, but then once it gets to a certain point, I'm like, well, okay, that is the Tangie, or that is the, you know, the OG or whatever. You can tell. I mean, it's pretty obvious at the fifth, 6 weeks, something like that. But for the first few weeks, you know, kind of up in the air.
Yeah.
Unless you have a specific leaf pattern or something like that. You
know? I'm not sold on Tangie. I'm not. I don't like the story. It just don't feel right to me.
Well, I'm biased. If it's publicly known that it's a jelly bean, then I don't understand how it gets the Tangie name thrown on top of it, first of all. And if that is the case, and it makes a lot more sense because of the flavors that I see, once again, not giving props to the right person, you know what I mean? It's like, is DNA running out with Tangie now when it's actually a subcool thing, you know? So, you know, and I had the same thing happen to me so many times that it's kind of like, I'd rather have somebody call it something with jelly or something in there, or at least give props to the person who did it and tell the truth. You know, so.
I agree 100%. Have you seen the Vice web video of Arjan seeking seeds in Colombia?
I haven't actually seen it, but I do know the guy that he was hanging out with down in Colombia. He's a good friend of mine.
Good friend of yours?
Yeah, this is a guy named El Gato.
El Gato.
Yeah, and he's the man. He was back. He came to Amsterdam in 2005, I believe it was, and. Yeah. He brought a video. He's the one that brought the whole Colombian test where they tested the 127 varieties. Huh. And then they decided that TH seeds were the biggest, most resin, easiest to manicure, which, in my opinion, were pretty much the criteria I'm looking for, you know?
Yeah.
I mean? And he's an awesome guy. He's one of the people who, if you see the photos from that actual thing they did in Colombia, uh-huh. It was amazing because they brought washing machines out to the jungle on backs of mules and didn't even put one ding in the thing. You know, you're like, how did you get this thing out here in pristine condition? You know, took high quality photos of everything, every bit of the process, from the cracking of the beans to the harvesting of the plants, and then documented their own tests within there. So they had, you know, 127 varieties to test. They had about 40 people that were out there. They all did their tests. They had like, you know, massage and food, and they really like tried to create like a real atmosphere, so these people could like kind of relax and chill out. And they had these sort of tree houses that they were all smoking up in and stuff, and sounded awesome. And I was like, wish I was there for that part. Sounds like the best cup ever. But on top of it, it was like, you know, the most realistic, because these guys not only were taking into consideration the effects, but they were also taking into consideration the growing techniques and like how the plant grew. So this was the biggest, the densest, the most yielding.
Yeah.
Which, that's the biggest problem, in my opinion, for most of the cups, is they don't really take into account all the rest of it. I mean, it's like, it's the best. Like, if you go to a cattle show, they bring the cattle out. It's not just about the beef, you know what I mean? They don't just come and cook a hamburger in front of you and say, how's that burger? You know, it's actually the process of the whole thing. So when you're growing the plant, I mean, it should be a lot to do. I mean, a lot of it should be about the yields or about the growth pattern or about, because that's what really you're out there to buy. You know, if you're going to buy seeds, you're not going out there just to buy the finished product. You're going out there to buy something that you need to know how it grows. You need to know, et cetera. You know?
Yeah, no, I agree with that. And see, going back to like talking about what strains or what and not and all this stuff, like, and not to call out a local friend, because dude's cool and we dig him, and I don't know the whole story, but Tangie won second place at the U.S. Cup here for, what was it? I mean, it wasn't the full U.S. Cup, right?
You mean at the first Cannabis Cup?
Yeah, at this last time, like, Tangie actually won, but see, it was Tangie OG or something, or it got renamed.
Oh, no, it was Tangie Cam.
Tangie Cam.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, but it was straight Tangie. That's the problem that I have right now at this point in time, is people not keeping names, and like they just because they think they grew it out and that they did something with it, added some nutrient, that it's something different.
Yeah.
No, fark your couch, dude.
Yeah. No, and I mean that is well, at a certain point we're gonna get into this, you know, like people are gonna start to map the genomes of these plants, and that's where we're gonna get.
It's starting to happen. That's what's cool.
Yeah, it's starting to happen, and that's gonna be an awesome thing. Some people will be crying, you know, whatever. But at the same time, we're going to find out one thing, which is that there's probably four to six strains that have been reworked like 1,000 times. You know what I mean? Because like too many times, you know, and every area has this because that's how it works. I mean, like right now, I don't think you can find Northern Lights on the menu at almost any shop, but yet it's probably the base of almost everything out there.
And that's what's crazy is like that. It's one of the best strains that we have. Almost lost.
Well, yeah, because people don't know what the original one is even like, because
no one's
claiming it anymore. You know, everyone's got the new name for it. So, you know, that's the classic story of how these things evolve so fast. I mean, there was a time when basically it's pretty much Northern Light, Skunk Haze, or the top three strains that were in Amsterdam when I was there. That's when I first came. Then they have, you know, Shiva Shante or whatever, and these are just also just offshoots of the original things. They're just different names thrown, and then the names got more and more filtered to the point where now we just don't even know where the original ones are, which is a shame, because I mean Northern Lights is a classic
White plant. Widow is something that disappeared years and years and years ago.
The problem with White Widow is it wasn't stable to begin with, and it came into the market very quickly and went out very quickly. It was only like maybe 3 years while it was there, and then after that it pretty much had lost its sort of substance, you know?
Mark Emery talks about how that being his favorite strain in the world when I had conversations with him, but it didn't exist anymore, that it was gone.
No, and it was a guy named Ingemar in Amsterdam who made it, and like I remember him coming into the CIA in 93, and that was, or 94 it might have been, and then that was pretty much the first sort of rounds of them. And everybody, you know, made a big, it looked beautiful, and it had some strength to it, but it just didn't have the longevity of a strain, you know, like it kind of lost its luster real quick.
Yeah.
And it didn't cross out very well. That's the problem too, is a lot of times people get, you get a really good F1, and you take that first generation seed, it might be awesome. I mean, you have some giants and some monsters, but you also have a lot of variables. So you got to go back and take that one and cross it back. Now, what happens is on your F2 is that you get a lot of crap. You get all sorts of crap. And you need to go further. And what happens is a lot of people don't go further. Because
F4, your 4 is like where you need to be at, right?
Fourth, fifth generation, you start to see stability to the point where you're like, okay, now more than 50% of the plants are looking the same. And you know, you can start to get into a rhythm where you're like, all right, now it's something. But so what happens is a lot of times people will give F1s out to everybody who then turn those into something. Now, what they've just turned that into is an F2, but it's not that they're back crossing or anything. They're actually crossing it out. So what's happening is it's getting more and more watered down every time. And the chances of finding that one are just that much harder, you know?
And not to call you out or anything on this, but one of my favorite strains, you know, was A-Train. Like, I loved it. It was fantastic. And I got to make a lot of oil from it because a few of the seeds that I popped, you know, I just hashed, you know?
Right.
But the hash was absolutely amazing. That's one of those strains that, you know, I kind of thought that maybe that if it was worked with a little bit more, would be super excellent. Is there anything else been done with like A-Train? Have you worked with that at all anymore?
Well, the thing is, when I came back to the States, I basically didn't have to bring like the train wreck or the OG or the sours or any of the things that I brought from America to Europe in the first place.
Yeah,
because that was half the battle, is getting it over there.
Yeah.
And so certain ones with the train wreck, I kind of just I love it. But it's just one of those strains that it's kind of hard to make seeds from. It's one of the really hard ones. Like it produces really tiny, tiny, tiny seeds, and they're really hard to get a good number. So it's kind of one of those. I kind of concentrated on plants that were just easier for me to work with.
Dude, it smelled like just beautiful, like a flowery red wine. The pheno that I had. I mean, I showed it to you.
I remember it. The thing is, with the
gorgeous.
Yeah, and like I had really good success with the actual plants themselves.
Yeah,
it just because as a seed breeder, you're also looking at combinations of some plants just don't produce good seeds, like yeah. they're ugly or they're misshapen or they, you know, they don't develop big enough, and so you end up with really low, you know, like you'll end up a quarter or even less of what you could have gotten with another strain. Yeah. So I mean, it's one of those ones where it's just because of the difficultiness of growing it, I'm sometimes putting it to the side.
What would you say here, chat room is asking, outdoors seeds, like what do you think right now is probably the best stability for working with outdoor situations?
Well, I mean, the thing about outdoors is you don't want short squat indicas outdoors like you do indoors, because you're not paying for any electricity, first of all, so you need some, and you want to get them up off the ground, so you do need some sort of hybrids, like plants that tend to maybe not work well indoors because they're like, I have a Matanuska Thunderfuck that's unruly, you know?
Yeah.
You can't even grow it. I mean, you could grow it indoors, of course, but it takes up fucking a quarter of your room.
So much space.
It's just ridiculous. So those space hog plants tend to be ones you like outdoors are awesome because that is the whole point. You're trying to get as much, you know, volume as you can and also girth off the plants. Again, like, I mean, I'm not a big outdoor grower per se, just because I lived in Holland, which is, you know, the most heavily overpopulated place in the world, so to find a little spot to grow is always like, it was never in nature, it was always on a rooftop in a pot, you know, so you're growing on a pot in a rooftop in a city situation where there's like light,
what about
ambient light that kind of ruins your crops.
What about heavy duty fruity, man? Because that's something that I've heard back from great, that does
heavy duty, does awesome indoors. Outdoors, I mean, kind of conditional if you were to live in a really good little microclimate that you got the right, you know.
What if you're in Cali?
Oh yeah, I mean, Cali. See, Cali's loving it because they pretty much can take almost anything off of my menu and grow it outdoors. I mean, they can grow hazes outdoors.
Yeah.
That's the difference. I mean, here, the best results I've gotten back from people has been my Dark Star growing here outdoors.
That's what I've heard. Your Dark Star
just keeps getting good results. I got guys down in the South, which, I mean, I hear yields and I don't really know what to say because it's like, I'm not there. I didn't actually put it on the scale. And so when people tell me crazy yields, like these guys down South told me they had a 14 pounder of Dark Star outdoors that was 12 feet wide and 12 feet tall, which, you know, okay, at 12 feet wide, 12 feet tall, it could have put out that much weight. It's possible. Never heard of anything like that in Colorado before, so I'm not going to say it's true 100%. But yeah.
It's too hard to finish out plants here, man.
Even getting a 2-pound plant outdoors here, I'm pretty impressed with, because, I mean, what I've seen is you need a greenhouse. If you have a greenhouse, then you can pull it off, you know, because you can do light depth.
Sage and sour, they're saying, kills outdoors. The green chill says.
Nice. Yeah, I mean,
your favorite strain is sage, so that's
still my favorite strain. And it's mostly because of the fact that it's got that adult vibe to it. You know what I mean? Like, it's not.
What do you mean?
It's just like an adult weed. It's like it got that like old school flavor that don't know if they're a kid. Because they're like, oh, what is that? A lot of times kids don't like sage because they think it tastes too sharp or something, you know? And it's like, no, it's not sharp. It's that hazy point, you know, like a pininess that kicks in, that's a little bit.
Botard in here says he has a friend that pulled a 500-gram sage plant indoors.
Oh, yeah. Nice. Like to hear it. Well, indoors, sage crushes it. I get over a gram per watt if I'm with my S6 cut almost every time. I get 1.3, and every time I grow it, I'm like, why the hell am I not just growing this plant? You know what I mean? I always have that feeling at the end, like, man.
I just gave some of the seed pack that you gave me. I gave to a grow store friend next door. So, because I knew that he was going to be able to pop them before me, and was like, you have sage? Like, you know Adam Dunn? Like, funny is, like, people come up to me and they, like, they figure out that I know you or somebody else. They're like, it's the same way I was when I first started JDR. When I sent off messages to Hemp Hoodlamb, be like, "Yo, can you sponsor?" And then all of a sudden, you're sitting in my living room with Derek one day, and I'm like, "This guy's just normal dude, chill, cool." It's just funny to me that the people that I'm surrounded with, they're so successful, they're gonna be crazy successful.
Yeah,
a lot of them probably even more successful. No offense than you are, but like, this boom is gonna create these people that are just multi. billionaires that are like event. Hopefully,
I mean, we hope so. I mean, it's one of those weird like
and own companies out the yin yang everywhere.
It's kind of strange how it's always seems to be the other guys that do it. You know what I mean? Like, how come they're doing so good? You know, but
I think that all the time. It drives me to drinking every single night.
But the reality is, I mean, then someone else is looking at you thinking you're successful. I guess so. So you know, it is.
It is that way.
And if you're going to talk about it monetarily, because that's pretty much how people think of success these days,
yeah.
And then I haven't hit it yet. So that's 100%. I am definitely not successful. So it might be the fact that I'm terrible with money, but not really. I mean, I have my wife. She's awesome. So she, you gotta have a good, you know, strong woman there to take care of your stuff.
Dude,
money being the most important part, because without her, I definitely would have probably sunk myself deeper, because I just love stuff.
Cece's just so awesome and nice, and like ever since you guys had your kids, she's just turned into like mom, you know.
Well, yeah, she's
mom, you know. Like,
I'm lucky enough to
tattooed Swedish mom.
Yeah, that's the best kind, right?
Perfect, dude.
And the reality is, I mean, having a kid is awesome, because I always tell everybody, like, I was never a breeder until that moment in my life, you know. So now I'm officially a breeder.
100%.
So that made me feel good. But also just being able to raise a kid here in Colorado is pretty awesome, because I lived in city life in Amsterdam for so long, and it's like, you know, to have a kid there is definitely rough. You got to put him on your bike and ride him through the rain, and you know, it's just like, wow, this is definitely a little more of a struggle. So it's been good.
Yeah, man, and I'll say this time and time again, man. You moved here at like you couldn't have timed your situation any better to move here.
Well, you know, the key to everything is timing, and that's with breeding is timing, with cooking it's timing, with live you know, everything is timing. So if you can,
no wonder why I fail.
If you can achieve the, if you can like master time, which is a hard thing to do, then you can definitely master all those things.
We were talking about the greenhouses a minute ago, man. Here in Colorado, there's some just insanity being like put up. Like, and these are what people are like. These are pictures people are posting. These are not ones that people are not posting, and they're like keeping on the DL.
Oh yeah, there's big things happening here.
The greenhouse that I saw, that we saw, that the greenhouse, the RD.
Yeah.
How big would you say that is? I mean, it's.
I mean, it's got to be at least 150,000 square feet or more. I mean, the thing is that what you got to understand with greenhouses in general is right now that seems big, but that is nothing. You know what I mean? Compared to what's out there. There's acres and acres under glass, you know what I mean, that are already out there that are being used for other things.
Yeah.
And all it's going to take is enough initiative or enough to be able someone to show on paper like, well, we need... You did this amount, you know, you did this many million last year.
Yeah, this.
Well, how about this? You know what I mean? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And this thing is like, I mean, like you said, 150,000 plus.
Oh, yeah. At least.
And
I mean, it could be
no walls. No walls in it. Like, there's. And then the other thing that I heard that it was told with it, that it's all computer controlled. Like, the lightness, like, there are shades that slide across the greenhouse in it. When time comes that it needs to be light deprived. So you're having multiple harvests a year in a greenhouse. Dude, the weed that's coming, and knowing the people that I know who are going to run that grow, the weed that's going to come out of that greenhouse is going to be some of the best that's ever come out of Colorado.
Yeah, no, it's going to be, I mean, the thing is also, I'm a big fan of greenhouse growing in general. Not that I had enough chance to do it because I lived in such a crappy place for it, but my, you know, going on tours in NorCal and checking out friends' spots, and it was always about the greenhouse, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like to be in NorCal and go into indoor grow was not exciting to me at all. It was like, this is blah, like, but to see the outdoor and the greenhouse situations going down, and then the outdoor was awesome because it's like, you know, full balls out, just going for it, but the greenhouse had such control and just proper looking product coming out of it that I was like, you know, that is definitely the ticket in the long run.
Yeah.
I mean that's definitely where I'm looking at. And also Colorado, you got 300 days of sun, so it's like, it's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, you have to be able to control those, that elements, man. There's Colorado. What sucks about Colorado is that you have those few times to where the weather just farts you in your a-hole and just, sure. like, it hates well, you. And especially later in the season where it's really, really, really...
Yeah. Well, know. I mean, the and then again, greenhouse is a big word. It means it could be just a little tiny 6x8 thing in your backyard, or it could be, you know, this 2-acre under glass type situation. So it's such a different... But it's such a different sort of set of growing techniques.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can kind of do the best of both. You can grow like you are indoors since you're under control with your humidity and your air and things like that. But you have the ability to get the full sun. I mean, because when you put a grow light outside, take a grow light, take a 1,000-watt and go outside and turn it on and see how lame it is. You'd be like, really? That's it?
Exactly.
That is nothing.
That's what's the cool thing about
the
all this
sun
is.
Just kills it, you know? So when you're inside a greenhouse, for instance, even if you're in a greenhouse that's been painted out white, so you can't see into the greenhouse, the amount of ambient light in there is way higher than a 1,000-watt light. So it's just like you're
it's crazy.
You're... ability to grow is so much bigger and more, and then you're not dealing with power and all that. It's just awesome, you know. Cause
man, it's like when I saw that, I was like,
oh yeah,
somebody's doing it. Like it's surprisingly surprised me. Like I shouldn't have been surprised. Like, but I was like, this is really happening. Like it was, I think more of like that. That this is starting to happen here. People are going to be.
It's literally like, I mean, the great one of the best parts about what we're doing now is that we get to live the dream. And a lot of those things, I mean, I'd have to base it all on Cheech and Chong half the time. You know, it's like just watching, like knowing that we can see like all the things we thought we would never actually see.
Yeah.
Like, you know, they're showing you big piles of fake weed during the movie. You know, and up in smoke when he goes to the upholstery shop and he runs through the upholstery. That to me, that scene was like kind of like I had to live that scene in my life somehow. You know, I had to see these giant things of weed and being, you know, loading them up and stuff. And now we've done all that. I mean, we've done that even 10 times over, it seems like. And now with these greenhouses and the amount of product that's going to be coming out of it, it's gonna dwarf even that idea.
Dude, and that's what I saw when I saw that greenhouse. All I saw was like, I wonder how, like, there's very few Coloradans that are going to get a piece of that. That's all going to go to people that are going to come here, mm-hmm. and then are going to end up shipping it out.
No, well, let's hope not. I mean, the thing is, I just hope that this whole situation goes fast enough that there's no need to ship anything to anybody because it's all where you are. And that's kind of where, like, the reality of, like, living in Amsterdam for so long and knowing that, I mean, I know plenty of people that would ship stuff back over to America from there, and I never did because I always thought, you know, hey, I want to live here for a long time, and nobody back home is really worth it. You know what I mean? That was kind of how I thought about it, because everybody would say they'd hook you up or something, but they never would. So I left that to other people to do, and you know what I mean? Like I said, it's the nature of the beast. People are going to always do what, you know, they're going to always push the limits.
And that's what's going to happen. I mean, it's going to happen. There are so many people right now outside of this state that are thinking that they're going to come here. They're going to buy quarters at a time, and then go and make a killing in another state.
Yeah.
Well, and in trouble and put a black eye on us at the same time.
Well, you know, that was my big argument in Holland was like all the, like, you know, Belgium and France and all these places would complain all the time about people driving over to Holland, buying a bunch of weed and driving back over to the border. I was like, well, then maybe you guys should start selling it yourself and then you'll make all the money. And I mean, is that simple? It's not complicated, you know?
But that greenhouse is huge, and I like already seen the plants that are in it. Holy shiz, man.
Yeah.
Like, congratulate. I'm not a big fan of the main company that handles it, but at the same time, congratulations, you know. I mean, I can't deny that, dude, whatever. Rare Dankness, I'm a huge fan of, but
for sure.
But the other main part of that. Whatever. God, finally the chat room. You finally brought some at least decent questions and like.
Oh, see, I brought decent questions.
No, at least people have actually responded like human beings for a period of time in the chat
good.
Room.
That's
so
good. That's good. At least I brought some humanity to this situation.
To this crazy ass situation. Anything else that you got? Any news or anything like that before I get to some news?
No. I mean, we're just cruising along down at the lab. Actually, this Thursday is tomorrow. Is tomorrow Colorado Day? Do you know that?
Is it?
I think it is.
August 1st?
I think August 1st is officially Colorado Day. I'm not sure. You might have to check that out. But apparently we were supposed to fly the flag over the Capitol, but since the Capitol's so covered up right now, it's not too exciting. It's like flying it over a sealed up box or something.
Yeah, for real. Like, even nobody knows. Like
you're like, what is that place? Is that an IKEA or something? What are you guys flying that in front of?
We've run out of money completely everywhere. The whole country, the state is... absolutely, you know, like searching for money, robbing marijuana cannabis funds, and then we're putting a gold, renewing the gold roof on our state capitol.
Of course. I mean, what else?
Oh, we gotta re-gold foil the state capitol. I mean, that's just so stupid. It's just like in what is it, in Detroit? Detroit's bankrupt.
Beyond
bankrupt, but they are building a taxpayer funded stadium.
Of course. Diversions. You have to diversions for the public.
This is ridiculous, man. God, give me a break. I guess, let's see. Where do I go next to the news? Michigan doctor. This is kind of a long story. We'll see how much we make through this. Michigan doctor warns of potential overdosing on medical marijuana. Among the many natural benefits, by the way, this from tokeofthetown.com. Among the many natural benefits associated with medicating with marijuana is the sheer lack of detrimental side effects like you see at the end of every prescription drug commercial. But in a half-baked attempt to combat a recent string of favorable headlines for cannabis research, those opposed to the plant are issuing a stern new warning to anyone who smokes or is even thinking of smoking pot. Abnormal cramping, power puking, and the need for a hot shower. This, they say, is what you are in for if you choose to smoke weed.
Power puking.
Abdominal. There you go.
Yes, there you go.
It sounds like somebody watched somebody do a really dirty dab, and then that's what they were like, oh my God, this is weed. Like the other day. I can't mention anything in the green room that happens. It's just, you know, that's an unwritten rule.
Of course.
It just can't, but... So I'll just stop there.
There you go.
I'm just going to stop there.
No, I watched somebody in Vegas do the dirtiest dab I've ever seen. It was disgusting. It was one of those...
Oh, you told me about this.
It was one of those deals where like someone left it on the table and nobody really touched it. And then this one guy decided he was going to do a 2-gram dab. And that was the only product on the table. So he made this little snake up of the... And I could just see by the color of it that it was disgusting. It was like a greeny gray... nastiness,
and he snaked it out
and he dropped it down onto an e-nail, and about halfway through
an e-nail, yeah, nonetheless,
yeah, so he could just power through it, right? So he's going for it, right?
An e-nail will fark you up if you're trying to hit a 2-gram dab, like, yeah, you're dead.
So he's about halfway through and I could just see he realized that this was the most disgusting stuff he's ever smoked in his life, and basically like looked up at all of us, and we all were like, what are you doing?
Like,
you
know, just like, stop, dude. Like, you can stop, man. You can stop. It's okay.
But I think it was like pride got him, and he decided he was going to just power through it, you know?
Dude, it always.
And then he did it, and he was sweating bullets, and he was looking at his girl like, he just was like, give me a drink now. Like, I just saw his tongue was hanging out. He had the most... And I went up to him, and I said, you know, you may want to do a real dab after that, because you're... contaminated right now. You are completely 100% contaminated.
Like you open up your parchment and be like, dude.
I was trying, but he couldn't do it after that. He was done. That was it. It was like party over, sweating bullets, out the door.
Like, dude.
It was pretty awesome, actually. And it was like, we all just looked at each other like, did he actually just smoke that? And I was like, wow, that was just like the stuff we all passed around like, no way. I saw some pretty nasty stuff. I'd have to say, like, one thing about I love about Colorado is With the concentrates, we definitely got it down. I mean, it's like
killing it.
All I saw when people were pulling out in Vegas were like these big, sappy, sloppy parchment papers that were like embarrassing.
You know, I mean, it was kind of hot in Vegas while you were there.
Oh, yeah. No, that's the thing is, I mean, you can't, it's hard to not auto butter your stuff anyway because of the heat situations. And if it's in a car and it's 100, you know, you leave it in the car for half an hour while you do something, it's 150 degrees in there. But basically, it was just.
Some people are figuring out, though, like, the crew over it.
Oh yeah, I mean, here we got it down. That's what I'm saying. Like, here
we got it down.
I mean, that was the nicest part, is that every time I showed somebody something, they were just like, how do you make it that way? And it was just like,
magic.
You gotta come to Colorado, my friend, because this you guys are a step behind. I'm sorry. You know, and they may not ever believe that because they are California or they're from wherever, but be careful, man.
You're gonna have the Californians mad at you now.
I can't. I'm just saying. Concentrates. Look at the first two letters. It's CO.
Yes.
It's not CA.
Dude, that is the best. I love you, dude. You are the man. Oh, you just pissed off so many people right now, and I love it. But the funny thing overall.
Well, I mean, it's just the fact that, I mean, when you're dealing with this, it is science. You know what I mean? We're not talking. This is not magic. It's not unicorns and magicness. It's reality and science. And the reality is, you need to do things in an organized manner. And probably the biggest problem, I'm sure, you know, if you're in Cali and you have the potential of getting charged with production of manufacturing of a drug, which is the same as if getting a meth charge,
yeah,
then you're not going to like spend an extra amount of money to make your product that much better. You're going to try to get it done as quick and quiet as possible. Whereas over here,
there's people that are doing it pretty good.
There are, but they're far and few. And the thing is, and I tried some stuff that was awesome when I was there. I'm not saying that everything is bad. It's just that the majority is still in the dark ages. You know what I mean? And it's the same here too. In the sense, it's like anything that gets really popular, you're always going to have, you know, a certain crew that is like top dog, and then you're going to have all the followers because it's just the way it is. You know,
I'm hearing through the grapevine. This is hearsay completely. I don't know this for sure, so don't quote me on this 100%. Supposedly, a couple people left Top Shelf Extracts yesterday.
Oh, really? Wow.
Which would be huge news. I mean, that'd mean a brand new company is coming, and also some other stories are going to be coming out of that. So,
interesting.
That's very, very, very interesting news. So that's,
well, you know, this
all I know about the situation.
This is a new industry, and new industries tend to evolve like that. There's a lot of buyouts. There's a lot of, you know, consolidations. There's a lot of times people joining up that you never would imagine joined up. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. There's always going to be a lot of fallout. You know, that's just the nature of the beast. And of course, it's proprietary stuff. It's like things like, you know, you're doing something your way.
Yeah.
And it might only take a guy a day to learn it. You know what I mean? It's not these aren't the most incredible techniques in the world. These are simple things that are just, but it is science. You know what I mean? So it's like, and then once you've cracked the code, yeah, people tend to like just go off and do their own thing, which is not always. Definitely not the right thing to do, but then again, you never know. Every situation is different.
Yeah.
Can't really tell one way or the other.
Man, people so stoked to have you back. They're like, does this mean CD Wednesday is back every day? Like, Adam Dunn's like speaking the Bible. He's good. Like, dude, people are stoked, right, man.
That's good. I'm good. Glad to hear everybody. Thanks for the support.
I got a few messages last night of like, this will be power move getting Adam to be on
basically
here.
This is my power move to get my ass out of bed on Wednesdays. It's pretty much what I'm looking at it for. Like,
hey,
I gotta get my shit in gear,
you know? Hey, if whatever we can do to do that and help you in that realm of everything, I'm good to go. Where the hell is this? There's a story I have too. I don't know if we'll get to it here, but I also saw a picture earlier. 420 marijuana found on Justin Bieber's tour bus again. And then last week,
he just wants a strain named after him. That's all.
No, but here's the thing: he was on a balcony like with friends last week, and there's pictures, obviously, of like everybody's taking pictures, and he completely denies it. He hawked a loogie off the balcony onto these female fans, and it landed in this chick's face.
Oh yeah, she still hasn't washed it off, I'm sure.
Dude, she was crying.
Oh, she loved it. Come on.
Probably.
You loved it.
But what a douchebag. Can
Bukkake, a bukkake in her face there. Like, that'll be the next round.
How can you be that big of a dick to like lean out your window and...
I mean, have you seen this kid? He's pretty good at it.
Yeah, obviously.
He's getting really good at being a dick, so...
Like, seriously. Like, there's a picture right there of it. Like, how can you deny that? You're on the balcony and you... what a douche. Anyway, marijuana
found... We know you love Justin Bieber. Now, come on.
Yeah.
You don't have to pretend.
Dude, if he wasn't such a dick, I mean, he may have. Like, he's got a few tracks that are decent. It's like Justin Timberlake.
All right. Now your true colors are coming
out. No, it's like... it's like Justin Timberlake. I didn't dig Justin Timberlake.
Justin anything.
When he was in sync or whatever, but...
Yeah.
You know, like, after he got out, you know, and did his whole thing, he became the pimp. Now...
Yeah, but he's funny, actually. Justin Timberlake is funny, and, like, he can act. He's a good actor. But I have to give that to him.
Beiber could have gone that way, but no. Now he just entered into douchebag territory.
Yeah. One of the things that was quite funny was at the Champ show, my friend's booth, he was the Medi-Cali booth, he was right across from this porn booth, and basically they had all the blow-up dolls, and they had a Justin Beiber doll. It was pretty funny. It said at the top of the box, it said, he's not gay. Well, maybe just a little. It was awesome. Actually, the boxes, I mean, I'm sure the dolls were ridiculously stupid, but the boxes were awesome. I mean, it was like, wow, you could just see giving these gifts out all day long, you know?
I'm not even going to take that any farther than where you just took it. So.
Well, I got you one. Don't worry. I got you your Justin Beiber doll. So.
Great.
Yeah.
Fantastic. That's so special. Next time you go to Vegas, I want to go. Maybe I'll have fun in Vegas if I actually go with you. Because any other time, fart that shiz. I hate that town, man. I don't gamble.
I don't gamble either. But and I it's funny. I've never been to Vegas until I moved here. This last 3 years ago or whatever, and I think I've been there about 15 times now. It's just like get dragged there all the time.
All on business, right?
It's always business. Well, except for I got married there too. That was the one non-business trip.
I didn't get to make that, and that was
Little White Chapel. Recommended to anybody.
Dude, everybody had so much
in
fun
and out
too.
Like a flat. I tried to do the drive-through, but my limo was too big. We had one of these tractor trailer truck limo things, and they wouldn't get underneath the thing, so I had to like go in and do it proper. But I was ready for the drive through. You know, I was like, "Boom, let's do this."
The fact that Cece's totally down and kosher with that is what's awesome, man, and it makes her. She's just a cool chick.
Yeah. No, I would always recommend anybody getting married. Just do it in Vegas. Get it over with.
I don't recommend anybody getting married.
Straight to the stratosphere after. That was fun.
I gotta get as high as possible now.
Exactly.
Oh man. An extensive study recently released by researchers at the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston. Deaconess. God, I can't read, dude. Deaconess. In Boston, it was determined that regular marijuana smokers showed better control over their blood sugar levels, displayed lower insulin levels, and overall had thinner waistlines than non-tokers. With the tide already turning towards acceptance of weed in the U.S., this particular story soon went viral, making the front pages of Yahoo News and being read by local newscasters on television across the country. Clearly, something had to be done, and so the anti-marijuana messaging machine sputtered into action, which, by the way, also included last week this story about how cannabis makes you crazy, which keeps coming out over and over and over again, but then you read the very bottom line was that everybody in the study that showed abuse towards cannabis already had some sort of medical condition or had serious predisposition to ending up with this whatever.
Schizophrenia.
Like, okay, people, let's get a bunch of people that are already going to be farked in the end of their life and then, like, blame it on cannabis.
Of course, of course. I mean, that whole 600% increase in schizophrenia, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
I mean, it always came out that the people were predispositioned to it, and that's why. And
exactly.
And that is the way it is. I mean, there's always a percentage of the population, approximately 1%, which is not, you know, that have a predisposition. It doesn't mean they're going to get it. It just means they're predispositioned for it.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I can always go back to high school, where I pretty much go back to everything that goes back to high school, right? Because that's when you learn all your social sort of parameters. And what I noticed was, in my group of friends, I always had one kid who just could not handle his weed, you know what I mean? And he would turn all weird on us and, like, start smashing bottles up against the wall or something, you know? Like, hey, we're hiding behind the school getting high. Probably don't want to smash bottles against the walls. Like, that simple of a thing. And realizing that kid just had some aggression problems, you know what I mean? And that when he smoked, it came out. Well, the other eight of us did not have aggression problems, you know what I mean? So
So
the reality is it's going to pop up here and there, but it's always, you know, it's the same kid that was burning up ants with a magnifying glass when he was 3, you know what I mean, or 4 or whatever. So he's like, there's always going to be a tendency in somebody to have some thing pop out. And I think weed, especially because of the timing, when you're like, I mean, I might have started a little early at around 11, but the average age, say about 14 or something, of kids experimenting with, well, that's pretty much a good way to figure out who's going to be crazy later on in life. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like when you flip out over a joint and start, you know, breaking stuff or acting weird, well, you might have a little bit of an issue that you might want to take a look at. And that might just be the best way to sort of figure it out. It's almost like a rite of passage. You know what I mean? Here, smoke this and let's see what happens. And normal. Aha, we found one, you know?
Yeah, I am seeing here on Earl Ripper's status that, yeah, he did. He left. Looks like Skipton and Earl Ripper left Top Shelf Extracts and now started a company called Early Crew.
Wow.
Wow. That's...
Major moves.
I mean, that's kind of big news, and I think... I won't get into any speculation or whatever.
He took the belt and left.
I like Earl Ripper. Phil's a great guy. He used to, you know, film the John Doe radio show back before we you know, took off. And you know, he's a good guy. So I wish them the best. Good luck to Dan now. Like, holy crap, is the flamethrowers are going to be coming out now. Like, whoa. That's crazy to me that happened. Like, damn. All right, anyway. With balls of steel that would make Superman blush, Dr. Cassius Drake, the medical director at the Henry Ford Health Brown... the center in Michigan we're talking about, is pointing to the previously neglected endocannabinoid system as marijuana's latest victim. He's claiming that THC, the active ingredient in weed, is detrimentally smothering the body's cannabinoid receptors in regular marijuana users, leading to a condition that he and his colleagues like to compare to morning sickness in pregnant women, which he says is the true reason why potheads have slimmer waists. Did you follow all that?
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
He refers to the dangerous new affliction as cannabinoid hypermesis syndrome. Cannabinoid hypermesis syndrome.
Love it.
Are you serious? Or CH. And if the name already doesn't scare you straight, Dr. Drake is not alone in his fears. The managing director of the Children's Hospital of Michigan.
Are these the same guys that didn't even know what a cannabinoid was about a year ago? Or
probably.
Yeah, pretty much.
At the Regional Poison Center in Michigan, doubles down on Dr. Drake's dribble, stating that marijuana typically causes the munchies, right? This is the anti-munchies. I mean, what?
So now we have to worry about whether you're going to get the munchies or the anti-munchies. And an anti-munchies would be a terrible thing considering people spend about $15 billion a year trying to get slimmer. So we got a problem here. We've created the ultimate thing. It can do anything.
Dude, like I just said, there is studies that came out that said marijuana makes you slimmer. Now they're trying to like spin it so that, no, marijuana makes you sick so that you can't eat. And then like, no, you get high.
It's not even that. It's just you get satisfied. The thing is, it's literally like a Snickers commercial. Like, you know, you do get satisfied. And that's the thing is when cannabis sort of satisfies not only your body, but your mind.
Dude.
So it's a combination of the two. And the fact that it actually causes people, I mean, and it's quite noticeable. I mean, you're skinny, I'm skinny, we're all skinny. All of us stoners are skinny. Look at Derek, look at all these guys. We're all, none of us have put on a ton of weight, you know, we're all pretty much high, like, kind of high strung, whatever. But at the same time, the cannabis is definitely not making it go worse in either way.
And
it doesn't make me not eat.
And here's the thing, about all this is like, you and Cece and a few other people I know are some of the like most healthy eaters. Do you eat chicken?
No.
You're straight vegan, right?
No. I'm aquatarian, I call myself.
Aquatarian.
Well, whatever that is. I made it up.
No, I mean, that's cool and all. And is CCV?
But I call myself a qualitarian now. That's my new idea.
There you go.
And so, you know, just quality.
But see, the point is, here in Colorado, you come to Colorado and you find stoners, they want to go to the vegan restaurant. They want to go to they want to eat healthy. They don't go to Taco Bell. When you were in high school... And after high school, you went to the Taco Bell and Burger King and all that. And now people will go to, like, Pho de Chow and, you know, sushi and all this other, like, it's funny. It's just awesome. All right. Fark that story. I'm done with that. It goes on to talk about how this polling numbers are being positive towards cannabis and people would like to legalize, and how this guy thinks that is all it's doing is really making you sick. So ridiculous. Let's talk about hemp for a second.
Sure.
Since you're the hemp man, are you on this hemp committee?
I am. I'm the first person on the committee, actually.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. Lots of good things are going down. I mean, right now, I think the biggest thing is the fact, obviously, that we are growing hemp here in Colorado. It's about 70 acres down south that are being publicly sort of talked about. A few other little projects I'm heard about going down, which is good. And I mean, again, it's just back to the same story. Like, we could all sit around waiting for them to tell us to do it, or we could just do it, you know? And I think just doing it is going to make much more of impact. I think a couple of the projects is some hemp homes are getting built here in Colorado. Mm-hmm. And I think that's going to be one of those things where you can prove to people the realities of this situation. Like, here, look, we grew the hemp, and we're going to build the house right on the same property. And then you can do this all over the place. And I mean, can you imagine growing houses everywhere you are? You know, it's just like, 1 year you create a whole ecosystem with birds and, you know, everything coming to you, to changing migration patterns, to fly to your hemp field, to eat all your hemp seeds.
Yeah.
And then the next year you're building a house on that property. You know what I mean? It's just like, it's awesome.
And the committee I was talking about here is the which it doesn't look like any of the people that it looks like a different committee here. Advisory committee. Let's see here. Who's on it? Stan Garrett is on it. Boulder attorney Stan Garrett. Ben Holmes, seed development and genetics. Chad Pfizer, citizen advocate. Troy Bowder of Colorado State University. Deputy Attorney General David Blake. Michael Bowman, a commercial farmer. Alonzo Abeda, hemp farmer from a cooperative. Ed Lerberger from Pure Vision Technology. And Tracy Shogren from the Hemp Store. So those look like the people. I haven't heard of.
I know most of those people.
Yeah, I'm sure you do.
Yeah, no, mine was Rocky Mountain Hemp Association, so.
Yeah, that's just different. The members of the committee have been chosen, and the group met for the first time in mid-July. Farmer-turned-political activist Mike Bowman was there, and Westward caught up with him on the progress. Bowman, who's a member, has high hopes for the group, which is assembled by the state, assembled by state lawmakers who sponsored the bill and created it. At the committee's first meeting, the 18th, Bowman said the members introduced themselves, explained their interests on the issue, and then got down to business. They spent the balance of the afternoon going through the particulars of what we were charged to do by the legislators. The result, he says, was a working document outlining what a registration and inspection process might look like. We want to have a streamlined process that's transparent and puts enough boundaries around it, and that we aren't going to be challenged by the feds as a program lacking oversight. Which, obviously, I think, you know, the situation with us here in Colorado having, you know, the state and the DOR regulate, I think that's a big reason why we haven't been, you know, and people notice that. So that comment right there, I mean.
Yeah, I mean, we have a major challenges just because it's kind of like the unknown. There's a lot of unknowns here, and there's part of that is you have to sort of walk lightly because the feds could always spin it in any direction they want. You know what I mean? They can do 1,000 tests on your field and come up with one test that registers over 0.3%, and then they can decide to plow your whole field in, you know?
Yeah.
So it's really like, obviously, we want to not push it too hard, but at the same time, really got to get them in the ground and get it done, you know?
Yeah.
But it's exciting times. I think the whole hemp movement, which was kind of interesting because when I lived in Amsterdam and we were considered the hemp movement of Holland, is because we were the only ones that were really doing it.
Yeah.
And it was so hard to get people involved because they just kind of were like, well, I can go down the street and buy weed down at the shop, so why would I even care about all this other stuff, you know? And we're like, yeah, but there's a lot more to it than just you smoking it, you know? There's the whole other aspect of hemp and how much that can improve your life and how much that can improve the whole world's life, you know what I mean? So, and you're by keeping it back, we're not progressing at all. We're actually regressing, you know? And that's where we definitely don't want to be. And the thing is with hemp, I think it's only going to be two years to 3 years before we can actually start making major moves ourselves, because it's kind of like the miracle plant where it actually you know, it's the driving force of everything.
So, why 2 years, though? Why? Because of legislation and, well, like, it's also breeding?
Just timing. I mean, we're talking about a crop, so right. Can't speed up crops. You know what I mean? There's only so much you can do, and can't spin the earth any faster or go around the sun any quicker. So, we pretty much are locked into our years. And you're also, it's a political and a physical challenge that we have to overcome.
Yeah, and one thing there's the rest of this article talks about is, you know, how that they don't want to make the rules onerous, you know, and overly ridiculous as far as, like, I mean, it feels like after reading this article, and what it feels like is that they're really trying to separate weed, cannabis from hemp, and really, really make some rules and point out that, look, it's not the same thing, let's treat it differently. And we're becoming the leaders in that.
Yeah,
I mean,
and that's the
by
main
far.
Thing. That's the main thing is, like, it's really hard for people to get it out of their head that it's separate. You know what I mean? Like, people are like, well, how are you going to do that? And it's not the same plant.
So yeah, how are you going to do it? It's already done.
You don't have to worry about it.
Worry. And they, I mean, seriously, you're one of those one people that, I mean, the epitome of, like, being able to sit down and explain the difference between the two of, like, look, this is, and what's cool is that we're changing that. Colorado is at the top of that, in the forefront. So
I just got the word that 2 p.m. tomorrow at the state capitol, we will be flying the hemp flag that we created and sent down with Mike Bowman to the capitol
So the same flag that flew over. The 4th of July at the United States Capitol, the same flag will fly
tomorrow at 2 p.m., which is Colorado Day, which I was mentioning to you earlier.
Hemp flag on Colorado Day is perfect.
It's pretty awesome, yeah. Dude. So that's the next big one. So, yeah, if anybody's available, come down tomorrow, 2 p.m., State Capitol, and watch some history being made.
Your mom sewed that flag.
My mom sewed that. Betsy. My mom, Betsy.
Sewed that flag.
Betsy Ace.
It's got Adam Dunn's stamp of approval, the Hemp Hoodlamb stamp of approval on it.
Awesome. It's pretty exciting times. Then after this, it's going to fly at all the capitals of all the states that have passed medical marijuana.
What? Really?
Yeah. And it's going to be followed around, and we're going to have a website devoted just to the flag. Follow the flag. Yeah. So,
dude, you
keep your eyes out for that.
This should have been, like, the first thing we talked about end.
I like to keep the little mysteries going. Plus, I just got the word. You know? Okay. Like, I just got the word.
You got your phone affixed, I see.
I got a new phone.
Thanks. Sorry for breaking yours again.
Yeah. I've never broken my own phone. I've always had other people do it for me. So thanks.
I have never broken a phone.
Thanks, buddy.
I never, ever broke a phone ever until I broke yours. And then I dropped my Samsung S3 broke it. So it's karma.
Perfect.
Yeah. Anyway, all right. Good times. Thank you, Adam, for hanging out with us today on the John Doe Radio Show. I really do appreciate it. Wednesdays with Adam Dunn, and then other days, you know, that you would like to join us on Skype and Skype.
Yeah,
it up.
I might jump in here from the garden or something like that.
Just let me know, man, if you want. Maybe I'll send you a message, you know, every other day or something. Say, hey, you want to join the Skype?
Sure.
Whatever, and then we'll talk about that. And
if I got something good to tell you too, I'll just give you a call. How's that?
Yes, and then, you know, I was like, oh, we have Adam today. I don't necessarily need to get a guest because usually we fill plenty of time between us. But here in the future, though, it's going to be cool sitting down on Wednesdays with you and talking to someone else and not just having it me and you, like talking about seeds or growing or whatever.
Sounds like a plan,
Stan. All right, man. Once again, thank you to everybody that makes the John Doe Radio Show possible. Couldn't do it without you. Thank you to all you trolls in the chat room. You guys rock. And they behave themselves very well today with you being here.
Yeah, some older guy around.
It was the elders,
and, you know.
No, it's just the respect is what it is, you know. They're like, here.
Thanks, so. Trolls.
And thanks to everybody that listens to the show. We couldn't do it without you. I hugely, hugely, hugely love y'all. And until we meet again tomorrow is Thursday, and I'll have a guest on. I just don't know exactly who that is going to be. I have a few messages sent out. I don't want to announce that yet. And so.
Thanks, guys. See you next week.
I'm your host, John Doe. See ya.
accept no responsibility for your actions or misrepresentations, and we do not fully endorse the use of illegal drugs. You are ultimately responsible for yourself.